Hello and welcome to this video from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallett, and in today's video we're going to take a look at Docker images and see how we can use a file system and use that file system to create our image. If you want to follow along with us, we're going to be working with Ubuntu 20.04. But just before we move out to the file system, we want to take a moment to reflect. We need to reflect not just on our physical health, but also on our mental health. We need to make sure that we can keep healthy inside as well as outside. It's just about this time a year ago that we lost our graphic designer, Laurie. Laurie was also the lady that you hear at the end of many of our videos, just congratulating you on reaching the end of the video. She was a bundle of joy and a very happy person to be around. It was March 25th that we lost her, and we want to make sure that this day is remembered as a happy day and not a sad day. For our family that's left behind, it's going to be absolutely amazing if you have a Twitter account that we can make hashtag Laurie trend on March 25th, 2022. So if you can do that, we'd be eternally grateful. I can absolutely assure you her family and her young 19-year-old daughter are going to be absolutely amazed that we can make this happen. So come on, let's show our appreciation and make the Laurie Day on March 25th a reality.
All that is left to say is thank you for watching. If you've enjoyed this, then you are probably sadder than I first thought. For more of this drivel, please subscribe, like and comment to @TheUrbanPenguin.
Hey, here we are on my Ubuntu 20.04 system. You can see I've got root access and we have Docker installed on this. What we're going to do is make sure that we can download a file system, and we're going to use that file system as an image. So the tool that we want on Debian-based systems is the deb bootstrap. So we can go ahead and do an apt install minus y on deb bootstrap. I've already done my apt update, so I know I've got an up-to-date package cache. So deb bootstrap. Give that then a big enter key. Watch the glorious package come down. And it shouldn't take too long, so there we go. Now that's then going to allow me to download file systems. You can always go through and check to see what file systems are available through the Ubuntu site. But we're going to create an image to download into. And obviously that image directory is now going to be empty. So brand new, clean and empty directory. We're going to use the deb bootstrap command. And we can then go through and tell it to download our images. And they're really based around the code names. So we can use things like focal, or we could use 20.04. If we just put in focal without a variant, it's going to download pretty much a full image. That's going to be about 340 meg. If we wanted a smaller variant of that, we could add in a switch for the variant. We're going to download the standard server image. So our first argument is pointing through to the image that we want to download. The second argument, I'm just going to call it focal one, is the directory we want to download to. Now we can give them the same name, focal and focal, but then you don't quite know what's going on. Remember I was saying that if we wanted to download a smaller image, we could do something like minus minus variant equals min base. Just check in the documentation of the deb bootstrap program and it will actually give you some of the variants that we can download. But it shouldn't take too long to download. Say it's about 340 meg. If you've got a reasonable network connectivity, then you're going to be able to download the full package. So we can leave this ticking over for a little while. Shouldn't take too long to come down, but say very much depends on how fast your internet connectivity is. So we can see it's chugging away, but we can then go through and wait for it to finish. Once it has finished, we're going to be able to see that we have got a directory. So that has now come down, and it didn't take too long to come down. So maybe a couple of minutes or so. But if I then go through an LS, we can see we've got the focal one directory, and we can check on its file size. So DU for disk usage, minus S for a summary, and H so it's human readable. If we didn't put the S in, we would see every single file in there. So we can see the total directory size is 340 meg. I say it's about 120 meg if we download the minimum base. If I go through and just do a listing, we can see what happens. What we were doing, we're actually downloading all of our packages, and we're expanding our packages into this target directory. So instead of installing, if you like, into the normal location, essentially we're downloading the packages and installing them into the target directory focal one. So we can now see a full-on file system, and we can import that file system. Now, we downloaded it, but you could create your own file system, maybe mount a disk and then bring it from that disk. To create an image from it, we might be even able to teach you a few extra commands for tar. So minus uppercase C is changing our working directory. And we want to change our working directory through to focal one. So we move into focal one. We can say then we want to create our archive. We're not using the option minus F because we're going to send to standard output, and we're using dot as the directory we want to back up. And that's going to be the contents of the focal one directory. We pipe the output through to our Docker image and import command. So this is going to read then our tar archive and import it into our local image repository. The minus here is saying we read in from standard output. That's quite normal to see that single dash when we're reading in from standard input. And then we can go through and call it, let's say, my focal. That's the name of the image that we are creating. That will just run through for a little while. Again, the dependency here is really on the speed of your disk system. But we've now created our image, and we're going to be able to see that image with our glorious Docker command. So Docker and image ls. We can then go through and see, look, it's the top image there, my focal. And we can see it's 322 meg compared to the 340 meg image that we started with. Remember, though, tar isn't doing any compression. All that we're seeing is more efficient use of the file system blocks. We have a 4K block size. If we populate that with a lot of small files, files that are not 4K, then there's going to be wasted space. Whereas we've only got a single file that's occupying all of that space, we've got the maximum of 4K of disk space that we're going to waste. So it's only more efficient disk usage and not compression that we're looking at. But now we've got an image. If we've got an image, you know what we can do with an image. An image is a template to create our containers. So tell me, why waste any more time? Let's go through and see our Docker run command and see if we can't fire up ourselves a container from this. So we can use Docker, container, and run. So that's the main command that we want. We want to run it detached. So it's running in the background, so it stays running. We also want to make sure then that we start the container with an interactive terminal so we can connect to it. And we want to then go through and specify minus minus name so we can assign a name to our container. It's much better to have a name for our container rather than the generated names. If we call it C1, we know then that we can refer to it later as C1. On my focal image, and then running bash. We haven't set a command for what command it should run, so we have to specify the command. We can now go through and use Docker container ps or ls, it's the same, but we can see then that that's up and running, and it's running the command bash. To attach to it, then to attach to that bash shell, we can run docker attach and then c1. Once we then connect through, we didn't set the host name, so we're just getting then from the ID of our container. But we can then go through and take a look at, let's say, our OS release file. So you can see then that, yeah, we've got now our own containerized version of Ubuntu. This is completely isolated from the rest of our system. And because the bash process is the first process to start up, there is no systemd running in the background here. We can take a look at the ps command and we can see that my bash shell has the process ID of 1. Now we do need to think about that, because if I exit my container, if I just use the exit command, we are shutting down process ID 1. If we shut down process ID 1, we are shutting down the container. So that's probably not such a good idea. But we can use control and P and Q to escape out of our container. So we can see now when we look at our container, it's still running. If I go back though and attach to it, exit it, we are now shutting down our process ID 1. Bash has shut down. So we can see then that our container is no longer running. The container is still there. It's just stopped. We would have to restart the container. But again, I'm really hoping this has been useful to you and that you've seen a little bit more about how we can create our own images. And I'll see you again soon.